juice box.
There you go.
Oh, thank you.
Don't forget the ice cream and the liquor.
I just love that. I love that bit because you guys light up so well. It just works so perfectly.
Here, you'll need this more than me.
What the? What'd you get me? Whoa.
There can be only one.
They're here.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Royale, where we keep it classy most of the time. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape, and welcome to episode 87. What the fuck's going on? I don't know. It's season 5. That's all I know.
How many hits has he taken tonight?
I don't know, people. This is just insanity.
Everybody's drunk. Everybody's drunk tonight. Great song, by the way, by Real Big Fish.
Real Big Fish. Good times.
I think that song clearly states the situation I am, because to quote the very last lyric, which is spoken, wait a minute, I'm not drunk. I have to drive all these people home.
So true, yes. This I'm saying it is episode 87 of season 5. Before we get into the contents of the podcast, let me introduce you to my brotherhood of cinema here, the bros of cinema here. First up, we got James Sullivan, also known as Hami Tude.
Tonight! this is going to be bad. Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by a very bad impression to homage everyone's favorite storyteller, John Hurt. Rest in peace, dear friend, and may the best place by the fire always be left for you.
That was almost like Simon Pegg doing the Professor Farnsworth voice. That was actually not bad.
And now, I would like to continue narrating the rest of this royale in this very voice.
It's not going to stay for long. And by the way, we did an episode on John Hurt 2 years ago exactly, so I'll link that episode at the end of this episode so you can click it afterwards. Then, the last but not least, our favorite of the bunch, Morgan Ledger.
No. Me, Claudius.
No. Me, Claudius, he says. Me, Claudius.
Mary Claudius!
But which one was really Claudius? I'll never tell you.
I'm cilantro.
I am the cheese. I am the most well-written character on the show. I am more well-written than the cilantro. Or the whatever it was.
Damn it, that's my line.
Oh, tonight we're going to talk about a certain actor of the name of Dennis Quaid. He is recently starring in the movie A Dog's Purpose.
We're boycotting it. I don't think we should make any reference to it.
I'm just mentioning the point.
Dog's Purpose.
I'm just mentioning the reason why I'm doing this episode, just to say, hey, he did this, but we are going to talk about his other works of the past before this. I mean, it's only got 33% of Rotten Tomatoes as of now of this recording, so, hey, I know.
That movie's going to lose money anyway.
Exactly. So we have to, I mean, Why, Dennis Quaid? Why would you sign up for a movie like this? I don't know. Just, bah. Anyways, oh, God. But let's just...
I'll let you know later.
Whenever we watch it, we might talk about an extra film, you know. Oh, boy. So, we have three particular movies, which has Dennis Quaid in it. Might be a main role in, and or supporting role in my case. But, hey. First off, we'll go in chronological order. So, first off, we've got Dreamscape with Morgan.
Oh, sorry, that's me. Yeah, I have the videotape right here.
Yes, the R-rated version.
Which is PG-13.
PG-13 in 84? Oh my.
Well, it was technically the first PG-13 movie, but what happened was Red Dawn beat them to the punch.
Ah!
Ironically, Dreamscape was the first certified after Temple of Doom, then
yeah.
Red Dawn came out. It's like, yeah, we're the first PG-13 movie in theaters! Damn it. So yeah, Dreamscape.
Dreamscape. Dreamscape.
Deja vu.
Inception before Inception.
Yes. If you want to get an idea of what Inception was like, if it was just a basic run-of-the-mill popcorn kind of movie, this is kind of it. Pretty much, it's this guy that gets roped into this experiment, and apparently he has all these psychic abilities and stuff, which is kind of neat. So he's pretty much the Artful Dodger, but with, like, mental kind of abilities, which is pretty cool. And apparently there's this little organization thingy run by Max von Sydow, who has the ability to enter people's dreams. And it's a really interesting concept with the way they work into it. The idea that when you enter someone's dream, there's the aspect where you could actually either die within the dream, or you can live within it. And it's such an interesting case, because we always wonder exactly what dreams are. Are they fortune-telling things? Are they life-experiencing things? When you die in a dream, do you die in real life? And that is something that's always been the many pillars of films that tackle dreams like this, like The Nightwalker and Little Nemo to a certain extent. And with this film, it's interesting because they not only show what it's like being in a very dreamlike state, but also the very different variations. There's the nightmare, there's the overzealous fear one, the erotic fantasy kind, and then you have the basic paranoia. And what I like so much about it is how each dream almost feels like a different film that you're entering in. And when you enter in someone's dream, it's a perfect excuse to, like, have different film styles and stuff. Like, there's this one where a husband fears that his wife is cheating on him, and it's in this very over-the-top Three Stooges kind of thing. There's one where he goes into a kid's mind, and it's very Tim Burton, like all these twisty staircases and everything. There's this boogeyman monster going after him. Mm-hmm. And it's just so interesting going into the psyche of these people's minds and seeing what their own, you know, nightmares and fantasies are like. And then you have the popcorn entertainment element of the movie, and that either kills the enjoyment or makes it interesting. Apparently, Dennis Quaid's character Alex learns that there's this other guy played by Christopher Plummer who's taking the dream people, well, actually one of them, who's a psychopath, and plans to put him in the president's dream when he's sleeping and try and assassinate him. And the president keeps having all these nuclear apocalyptic nightmares and stuff like that. And really break that down. The president is being assassinated when he's having a nightmare. Like, just saying that out loud, it can go either way on paper. But I think for me, I thought it worked in the stylist sense. Yeah, it's ridiculous on paper, but I think what makes it work is that when you're entering in the president's, you know, nightmare, it's like you're entering into his own psyche. Like, this is his own fear, him running the country, and it's going to turn like this. Yeah, it gets way too much in the climax with, like, the zombies and everything, and seeing DC as this Mad Max kind of universe, all these hell beasts and everything. But at the same time, it's like, yeah, if you were the president and you were running the country, you kind of have that kind of fear too. Like, if you were the one with, like, the big nuclear codes, you know that you're going to be behind the vehicle, that you could either turn this into a good thing or just, you know, turn it to a negative thing. But regardless, I think what makes it work the most is Dennis Quaid's character, Alex. When you really look at this character, he could become... His qualifications could have made him a 100% jerk, and the film wouldn't work, but yet there's something likable about him. He's a very cocky Han Solo, kind of badass sort of character. He's not really sort of like trying to have, like, oh, dreams. No, he's actually... He knows he's part of it, he can't get out of it, and I think that's what really makes it interesting, because he doesn't have a soft spot, but at the same time, he's not, like, a bigot or an a-hole or anything. He's just sort of goes through and says, okay, you know, I'm gonna go into this whole thing. And I think that's what makes the movie work pretty well, because it's a very out-there kind of premise, but at the same time, it's done very well. I mean, yeah, Inception took that up a notch, but even then, Inception was all about going within a dream, 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 within a dream.com. And it's ironic because I think, was it before or after? Around the same time, there was another dream movie that came out that kind of did it a little better.
Around and about Dreamscape or that other movie.
The other movie I'm referring to is made by the late but great Wes Craven.
Oh.
Right, Nightmare on Elm Street, because that was the other one that goes into dreams.
And it's hard, too, because when you compare the two, they're both very different films.
They
Dreamscape,
are.
Yeah, Dreamscape is more about dreams in general, whereas Nightmare on Elm Street, it's a much more interesting one.
Mm-hmm.
The idea of what the boogeyman is, you know, out of control and stuff. And that's a good one, too. And, you know, by all
classic.
Means... Yeah, when you compare the two, Nightmare on Elm Street is definitely... the one up, but with Dreamscape, it goes into dreams in general, to
mm-hmm.
just in general, and
yep.
you know, different imaginations and such. And I think what makes the movie work is not just the concept, but also Dennis Quaid and the fact that he's the straight man to all this. So when he's going into, like, different minds and stuff like that, you're really connecting to him because he's experiencing this for the first time and going against these really weird things, like this kid who has a boogeyman called the Snake Man that's constantly going after him, and the Snake Man is this Godzilla man in suit kind of monster thing.
And stop motion.
A little cheesy, but it's very fun. It led to probably one of the funniest and best Siskel and Ebert arguments. Ebert gave a thumbs up, Siskel gave it a marginal thumbs down because he wished it was a little more serious. But then Ebert, for no apparent reason, for a good 2 minutes, they went back and forth about whether the Snake Man was scary or not. I'm not even kidding. It was a weird fascination. And then Ebert was all like, wait a minute, Gene. If a kid, because Gene mentioned it looked like, you know, it was a model in like a 10-cent model in a model shop. And then Ebert was all like, wait a minute, Gene, if a kid actually saw that creature in a model shop, he would be scared of it, so it doesn't make sense, so it would be realistic. And then Siskel's like, I get the point, too, but I want to be scared, and that thing wasn't even scary. And then he completely owned the argument by telling Ebert, I am surprised he didn't end the conversation by saying case closed, so I'm going to say case opened. And then right before, I'm not even kidding here, right before he goes into Buckaroo Banzai, Ebert just stands there for like 3 seconds, his mouth open, he's like, our next movie.
I think I remember you showing me that clip eons ago.
Yeah, it was beautiful. It was beautiful. What is it? He's always there. I should have mentioned the controversy, which is why I brought this here. It's a little small, minor nitpick of a controversy. In the nightmare scene where the wife is cheating on the husband, apparently there's a key shot that's not in the American version over here, where apparently you see a whole lot of cleavage, if you know what I mean.
Some hoo-has.
Exactly. Supposedly, this is in the international version, and thankfully it's a copy that I got eons ago, but there's a whole lot more than that. Apparently the train scene where Kate Capshaw, yeah, she's in this movie, has a dream sequence where she's on a train and then Dennis Quaid enters her dreams and they make a little whoopee, and there was like a short 10-15 second bit where like she opens up her shirt and you see like boobs and stuff. That's not in the American version. Let me tell you, when I was watching this movie again with these guys, I tried to stay awake as good as I could to see Mike's reaction. The best I could do was at least see his reaction to the snake man, and that was it.
Yeah.
But I was like really disheartened to hear like, oh, it was an okay movie. What do you mean it was an okay movie? It's fucking Dreamscape.
Jesus Christ. I mean, okay.
Snake man. Hellhounds getting like electric boogaloo, zombies, Christopher Plummer, Norm from Cheers.
And then, just like he's never done before, Morgan went all off on Titanic for not liking the movie as much as he thought.
It is a sweet spot in a guilty pleasure kind of way.
Okay, because Morgan sent me this movie as a birthday gift, and I didn't watch it until so we ended up watching it later on after my birthday, and then, you know,
it was the version that had tits.
And I like the tits, goddammit, but here's the thing.
No, Clarence, I want the boobs. No.
It is a great 80s movie for its time. It's Dennis Quaid does a great job. He, like Morgan said, he was a straight man out of all of it. He's trying to save these people from their dreams. And, of course, you have David Patrick Kelly as the foe of Dennis Quaid being the other sidekick that can go into dreams, that the assassination for the president. It's funny because I remember David Patrick Kelly very much because he was in other movies I've seen in the past. But
like Commando.
Yeah, Commando, and then Warriors. So, yeah, it's good to see him in this. It was just good. But, yeah, I mean, Dennis Quaid's acting in this was just, yeah, it was very straight and straightforward. But there was just, like, they were trying to explain, like, you had to be hooked up to this machine to actually, you know, get into dreams. But then, all of a sudden, Dennis Quaid's character can actually have the ability to go into dreams without the machine, so he's like going inside of Kate Capshaw's mind. And I was like, "What the fuck?"
That's an important development too.
It was
because earlier in the movie it shows he has psychic abilities, not on a grand scale, but on like a minor sort of scale.
Yeah.
And this is the kind of character that would use it in a very jerky way, but he kind of sort of doesn't. Yeah, he's paying off his debts, but he's not like conning people or anything.
Yeah, it was something. Then the Snake Man just threw me off. It's like, whoa, 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 Snake Man, whoa. Yeah, and the Hellhounds are pretty cool looking, and I don't know, I just thought it was okay. I thought it would be something on the grander scale. I thought, because when I looked at the poster and I thought of the titles, like Dreamscape, I thought it'd be like Indiana Jones Meet Dreams or something, where you would be like exploring dreams, you know. But
mm-hmm.
It was something.
I saw, the first time I ever saw this movie, it was the television AMC cut, which is sort of a bit of a running gag between me and Morgan. If I've seen a movie on TV once, it's like, is it the AMC version?
Wow, I can't believe they cut out the BDSM thing from, what was that film? Motel Hell.
Motel Hell.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, but when I saw it on TV, I thought it was actually fairly remarkable and surreal in its approach to everything. The visual effects are a bit dated. The Snake Man effects are very much of their time, but that doesn't bother me. That really doesn't bother me. What I think what they're trying to establish when they show Quaid's character can enter dreams without the help of a machine. That machine seemed to be there just to exercise his skill.
Yeah, that's what it was.
You know, that,
yeah.
That's just sort of a booster shot, if you will. He's already got all the skills that he needs.
Right.
But, yeah, it's just sort of, okay, focus, what can you do? It's a bit confusing with the subplot about him paying off his debts, but
it was kind of only only minor.
Yeah, I liked where they went with this, and I liked especially Mike's reaction to the payoff at the end of the film, because there's just one.
I wish I was there to see that.
I'm not going to give it away.
Oh, the bad guy's going to get me in the elevator. What's this?
Make sure to tell him Large Marge sent you.
Twist ending? What does it mean? The only way that ending would make even more sense if they had the Dream Man from Twin Peaks there going, I have good news. That gum you like is back in style.
Let's rock. I enjoyed watching it a second time. You know, tits and all. Seems more like the director's cut that way.
Well, according to the Shot Factory, they tried to find the missing footage, but it was unavailable, and even if they did, they have to go with, like, legal fees or something.
Right, of course, when you're trying to distribute it, you know, yeah, of course.
Alright.
Well, interesting enough, we're going from 1984 to 87 for the Joe Dante film that actually won an Academy Award.
Oh, yeah. I need to tell a few things first, though, about my choice here, or shall I say the evolution of my choice.
Yep, go ahead.
Initially, I was going to do The Rookie from 2002, because that was Dennis Quaid making a comeback in his career during a time when films like Remember the Titans and Miracle were being produced by the Disney company, and they were like, oh, people like inspiring sports movie stories again. Let's do something like that. And The Rookie was a fun movie, but I had not seen it in ages.
Right.
And I didn't quite think about how to locate it.
Of course.
So I'm thinking again. I looked on Netflix and I found some movie that he was in with Danny Glover and Jared Leto, where he's a CIA agent who's trying to track down a killer, or an FBI agent, maybe serial killer deal, and he's playing that role very straight, but it seemed interesting, but at the same time, it was really kind of boring me. It was putting me to sleep, and then it hit me yesterday. Why don't I just talk about Inner Space?
Yes, Inner Space is the movie we're talking about. And it, oddly enough, it kind of fits in with Dreamscape where he's going inside somebody.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, what's this theme with Dennis Quaid going inside of people?
Yeah, what the hell? First dreams, now the actual body of somebody.
Here's the beauty of this film.
Go ahead.
You've got 80s Joe Dante and Steven Spielberg together. What could possibly go wrong? It's already amazing on that front. But then you add in Dennis Quaid, Martin Short, and Meg Ryan, along with the cast of Joe Dante regulars, Robert Picardo, Kevin McCarthy, and Dick Miller. Yes, the drinking game I have not forgotten.
Is that why you're drunk?
Yeah, that makes sense, actually. Did the Joe Dante drinking game.
Alright, I'm gonna watch in your escape. Let's see, where are the rules? Alright, here we go. I'm Dick Miller. Mm-hmm. There we go. Jerry Goldsmith. Hope he doesn't have a cameo. Gotta save that for later.
And, yeah, so the plot of the film is Dennis Quaid plays Lieutenant Tuck Pendleton, a Navy pilot who's been discharged for being for reckless behavior, and so instead he decides to do the next most logical thing, which is to sign up for a lab experiment, and have himself be shrunk down and miniaturized and injected into the body of a rabbit.
But uh-oh.
However.
But uh-oh, something happens.
Uh-oh, something happens. This type of technology is pretty hot stuff. So right in the middle of the experiment, Dennis Quaid is inside of this space-like pod, which looks like something out of the Explorers, another Joe Dante movie, another classic, and he's stuck in a syringe, but the lab is attacked by a rival organization that also wants the shrinking technology, and so one of the lab guys escapes, and while outrunning an assassin at the mall, decides to inject Dennis Quaid into the nearest body that he can find, which is the most neurotic guy you could possibly ever imagine, played by Martin Short. Jack Putter, a guy who works at Safeway as a cashier, who doesn't have any plans to do anything interesting with his life. But now everything's changed, and he comes to realize that he's got this little tiny band stuck inside of his body, and he's only got 24 hours to get him back out again before Tuck runs out of oxygen.
Well, that's pretty easy. Why don't you just go fly to the lungs and just open a hatch, be like, succulent air, succulent H2O.
But they explain in the film that would cause the pod to decompress and re-enlarge. It's complicated.
Oh yeah, I missed that bit. It's been a while since I've seen that movie, but I remember good things about it. But you first.
Well, what I like about this movie is that it's an excellent blend of just by the elements alone, it's an excellent blend of science fiction and comedy, because Dennis Quaid. I just want to say this about Dennis Quaid. We've already mentioned some other references earlier on this podcast: Han Solo, Indiana Jones. I just want to say, Dennis Quaid, I've already said this before to the group, Dennis Quaid is the guy that you get when you can't get Harrison Ford. He's got the same smile and same sort of cocky attitude that he can channel and everything. And now I actually have proof of that theory because according to the IMDb, we have okay, let's see. All the actors considered to play Tuck Pendleton were Mel Gibson, Kevin Costner, Patrick Swayze, Tommy Lee Jones, Jeff Bridges, Richard Gere, Michael Douglas, Harrison Ford, Bruce Willis, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Sylvester Stallone, Michael Keaton, Tom Hanks, Jack Nicholson, Robert De Niro, Al Pacino, Michael Norrie, Jeff Goldblum, and Kurt Russell. I wonder how many people they had to nudge down the list just so they could get to Dennis Quaid. Oh, here's that guy that did Dreamscape. But it's honestly it's so bonkers at the same time of a film because for something that's just a pod shrunk down to the size of a cell. They really hook him up with a lot of interesting gadgets. Like he's got this whole he's got all these mechanical arms that come out on the side. He's got a radio that he can use to communicate with Martin Short's character. He sticks it in the guy's ear. And he's got some sort of facial muscle reconfiguring device that turns Martin Short into Robert Picardo for a brief period of time, and this is partly why I think the movie gets a lot of props in terms of its special effects, because just look, take a look. There we go.
It looks like he was morphing into Christopher Lloyd for a second there.
Yeah.
Yes.
Like, doesn't it look like it?
It's a cross somewhere between.
Oh, now he's turning into me.
It's like a combination. This is brilliant. This is a physical effect right here, and it's brilliant. It's like a combination of Beaker from the Muppets, Roger Rabbit, and yeah, you get the idea.
I should have had those cookies before I went 80 miles per hour. There's something in these brownies. I'm pretty sure it was something Colombian. Everyone knows Taxi. Look at the reference.
The later incarnations of this phase are a lot more cartoonish like, but that's one of Joe Dante's trademarks is actually getting some sort of homage from a cartoon in there. In this case, we have a Bugs Bunny plush that Tuck has during his research with rabbits, and of course the lab rabbit's name has to be Bugs. So, but then you got effects like that, which are so freaking amazing, and that got the Academy Award.
Yeah, and it's only Dante's only Academy Award.
Mm-hmm. I'm looking through the trivia for this, and I'm saying to myself, a lot of this is not. There's so much brilliantly executed physical effects in this movie, not even rotoscoped in, not CGI, because of course it was too soon before it was going to look good, but just the effects that you see inside of Martin Short's body, of the pod going through his different bloodstreams and everything. He's traveling alongside there with fluids and red blood cells, giant red blood cells. And I looked at the trivia, and the red blood cells are made out of Jell-O.
Because the Jell-O tastes good.
Keep that in mind if you ever watch this movie. I would never have been able to tell.
Just like how you were unable to tell that a 1 second animation cell of a water droplet can be scary in Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
Exactly. That's another interesting point that I want to bring up about this film, is that these rival companies, they talk about, this miniaturization technology is the next big thing. This is the next bit of technology that we need to get our hands on. Well, the question you should ask yourself is why? What is the purpose of shrinking down something to the size of a microcell to stick inside somebody's body? And there is one scene briefly where they explain the purpose of the exercise, and one of the scientists says, the purpose of this exercise, we wanted to see we could shrink down a host cell, inject it into a rabbit, and have it communicate with the optic nerve. That was the whole purpose of this experiment in this movie.
But instead, he took that wrong turn to Albuquerque.
At least in, you know, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, we have Wayne Szalinski explaining to a group of people that the benefits of such technology could be huge. We could have mass transit shrunk down to microscopic levels, and that would decrease energy as we transport things. That's a good idea. This is their stated purpose in this movie. We just wanted to shrink something and stick it inside of a rabbit.
The more I think about it, you know, Mythbusters. The more I think about it, when you really see what Dennis Quaid is doing to Martin Short, you're kind of thinking to yourself, if he was really in that rabbit, how painful that would have been. Really, because when when he's clipping onto Martin Short and everything, Martin Short's like, my brain, the eyes, It's like, dude, if he was in the rabbit, that would be so much more hard to watch.
Ah, yes. And for those remotely curious, Meg Ryan does have a role in this too. She's Tuck's girlfriend, who's a news reporter, who ends up getting mixed up in the middle of this as her next big story, by way of Jack having to pull her into this and say, "Hey, I'm a friend of Tuck's. He's inside my body," but she's not going to believe that. But One area where I call bullshit, major bullshit, and I didn't quite get this even as a kid watching this movie, was there's one scene they have to convince, of course, at one point, that Dennis Quaid is inside of Martin Short, so he says something that only Meg Ryan would know about their relationship. I'm not going to spoil what it was, because it's kind of a nice scene, and she looks over at Martin Short and she gets turned on, like, it is Tuck inside there, and she gives him a big fat kiss. Later on, Tuck realizes that he's lost communication with Martin Short. Dennis Quaid realizes he's lost communication with Martin Short. So he's going around inside of, presumably, his body. And he comes across a fetus. And he realizes that his girlfriend is pregnant and that he's inside of his girlfriend. Instead. So many questions are raised by this. But, like, why she split up with him but never told him that she was pregnant, like, even after the fact. And two, how did he end up inside of her body? Did they French kiss? And,
I have a theory, but it's a little too dark.
Did they French kiss and he gets sucked in there mouth to mouth? And why? And if that's the case, why didn't he end up in the stomach and in her stomach somewhere and get dissolved?
Let me put it this way: you know the opening credits to Look Who's Talking?
Mm-hmm.
Imagine Dennis Quaid just going in front of all the army of sperms and stuff. You have these little drones, and then Dennis Quaid going,
I'm inside of Lydia.
Screws me, out of the way, coming through, got some business to take care of.
It'd be like Junior all over again.
Mama!
Mama!
That'd be kind of a twist, wouldn't it? Martin Short and Meg Ryan are like, oh, I felt so sorry for my boyfriend, I wonder what happened to him, at least I have this great comedian here. Congratulations, it's a boy, Dennis Quaid. You betrayed me!
Well, that explains why they considered Schwarzenegger for the role, because they knew Junior was coming.
That'd be so...
Dante is magic.
That would be a so, so dark ending if it went that route.
God. Okay. Morgan, your 2 cents?
Yeah, it's been a long time since I've seen it, but I do remember enjoying a good chunk of it. The ending, I still feel very miffed about. Because the way they ended on such a cliffhanger, it's like, no! Don't end it there! Come on! Don't leave it on such an open hook! Do you expect a sequel of things? And if they were going to do a sequel, I'd be curious to see where it go. Maybe it's a joke, like with Back to the Future Part 1, where the DeLorean flies.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably what it was. But in any case, it's a perfect idea of taking an old idea and making it new. In this case, Fantastic Voyage, where we were going inside someone's body, and we had antibodies and all sort of stuff. And it's actually kind of interesting seeing Dennis Quaid just controlling this person at a will. And like you said, there's literally 2 movies in one. You have a science fiction fantasy, and you have a comedy. So you have Fantastic Voyage, but on the outside, it's pretty much all of me, but with Martin Short.
Would that make it a Steve Martin Short?
It comes full circle now. I feel bad because this is a good movie, and you know, thankfully a Blu-ray is released of it. I wish it got more of an audience. It's another one of those movies of Joe Dante's filmography where the cult following's there, but it's not big enough.
Well,
again, just like with Dreamscape, it's a very goofy kind of premise, but it's really handled in such a good way.
Well, that's the thing though, because recently,
I didn't get to my favorite scene, where the bad guy goes inside to get Dennis Quaid out, and they're in the stomach, and so he somehow dunks the bad guy in the stomach acid, and the bad guy's like, and he like comes back as a skeleton or something, and then Dennis Quaid's like, congratulations, you just digested the enemy, and just cuts to the Martin Short, and he just burps. like that was funny.
Part of that was he...
I mean, it was a little dark, but it was hilarious.
Oh yeah, that was a good scene. I didn't mind that when I was a kid. I was like, oh, he deserved it.
Wow, Martin Short is a cannibal.
but yeah, Dennis Quaid is hanging out inside the stomach, just above the stomach acid. You know, he's got this rappel. He's got this grapple hanging his pod over everything, and he's just like, okay, Jack, I need you to get a bunch of stomach acid for me right here, right now. And I'm looking down at that stomach acid. I'm like, that's dip. It's green. It's watery. It's bubbling up and everything. Martin Short's like, I can't do that. He says, okay, well, I didn't want to tell you this, but I think I found the sort of a growth inside of you somewhere. It might be a tumor or something. And suddenly Martin Short starts freaking out and his stomach level starts rising. Here's another fun thing. Are you guys, I also believe that, this film was the inspiration for a ride at Epcot Center.
Is that still working, or did they end that one?
Body Wars?
Yeah, Body Wars.
Yeah, it closed on 2007. I had the honor of going there with my grandparents back in 2003, mm-hmm. and experiencing the ride for what it was worth. Mm-hmm. But I think while watching it, though, it really did sort of remind me of Interspace to a degree, because once you see this movie, it's really hard to replicate. So for something that I actually had to rent for a highway robbery degree of money, seriously, $4 for, when I was a kid, we rented movies at the warehouse for $1, even less.
If you want to go the extra mile, it's free at the fucking library.
Yeah, but you have to you have to reserve it ahead of time.
Yeah. It only took me 2 days, and Stay Tuned came in. Played fine.
Okay, well, good for you. I was on a short, Ben. I made this decision yesterday.
Yeah. And I was gonna say, in recent years, actually, just recently this month, I believe somebody was writing an article about the movie, and Joe Dante on his Facebook page shared it, and he's like, what's this now? What's with all the love for Interspace now? So it's coming like a resurgence now. Like, people are starting to get to notice the movie a little bit more, so it's going to pick up maybe with the cult following. So.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. You guys want to do a screening of this sometime?
Interspace? Yeah.
Sure. We shall make it a date.
Okay. wish I'd done that sooner.
Okay. Yeah,
Morgan, put it on the list.
Already on it.
Okay, guys. So, I debated for a while. I debated on what to watch. And this is a recent one. This is Dennis Quaid in the late 2000s. This film was supposedly claimed bad. It was not screened for critics. Dennis Quaid only got the role because his son insisted he take the role for the movie. Mm-hmm. He is a supporting character in this movie. Let me explain that.
Is it the day after tomorrow?
No.
Damn it.
No. His role was small at first, but the director actually liked what he did with the role, and they added more scenes with him in the movie. It is based on a property of the past, and fans of it were so pissed off at it because it wasn't faithful to the source. Sounds like something that happened recently, actually. But I end up watching...
Movie 43.
I end up watching G.I. Joe, The Rise of Cobra.
Oh, that's just child's play.
I've heard a bunch of shit about this movie, and I'm like, what the fuck's wrong with this? It's not like it's... I did a lot of research on this movie, and I... Okay, so... I know this is about Dennis Quaid, and for what Dennis Quaid did in this movie, he was fine. He was good. He played General Hawk, and he was just basically the leader, the group hold of the G.I. Joes, the Joes in general. So he was good as a leader. He's got that voice where he's like the leader, and he's got commanding voice, and he's got a couple of jokey lines here and there. It's really good. He was good in there, but otherwise, this movie's not that bad. People are just making... a lot of, like, hooey-balooey about it. It's like, first off, it's not based on the cartoon. It's based on the comics. So, if people are expecting it to be based on the G.I. Joe cartoon, it's not. Because the director, which is Stephen Sommers, I believe, who directed The Mummy. It's funny, because I was watching the movie and you get a Brendan Fraser cameo. Brendan Fraser pops up in the movie, and... because Brendan Fraser just asked him, was like, hey, could you add me in the movie? Because this would be the fourth time collaborating together. Can you put me in the movie? And they put him in the movie for like one or two scenes. It's like,
oh yeah,
that's Brendan Fraser.
An uncredited role as a drill sergeant.
Yeah, just one of those generals. It's just like, but okay. It's, like I said, it's based on G.I. Joe, the comics. It sets up the Joes, G.I. Joes, Cobra. And it's basically, you got Christopher Elkinston. Okay.
Eccleston.
Thank you, because that last name fucks me up. And he played the Ninth Doctor of Doctor Who, and he plays this secondary villain who has these nanobots who's willing to launch them into the world, because then about like nom 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 eat. So the first attack was in Paris, where he shoots him at the Eiffel Tower.
Is that one of the best you got? Om nom 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 nom. It's like fucking Pac-Man.
That's what the nanobites do. They just bite and eat everything up. It's so funny because, and you see it going at Eiffel Tower. It starts melting, eating everything. Just, and I was reading one review, and it's like one review is like, "Gee, I think they got leftover slime from Ghostbusters to do the nanobots."
Like, oh no! No, 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 no! Keep Ghostbusters out of this.
I know, and I was like, "Whoa, dude! Keep it out of this." So, all right, you got Channing Tatum, you have Marlon Wayans. I mean, they complained about Marlon Wayans being, like, unfunny. I mean, he was okay. Channing Tatum was okay.
They all got replaced in the sequel.
And, see, I'm going to...
Hey, this sequel had Bruce Willis.
I'm gonna watch that sequel because it's a soft reboot. It has continuity from the first movie. But it's a soft reboot, so I'm willing to watch that to see how it fares out. I mean, they were thinking about doing a Transformers G.I. Joe crossover at one point. So you could imagine what that would have been. But
it would have made a worse G.I. Joe movie, but it would have made a better Transformers movie.
Yeah, I mean, it did what it did. I mean, it set up kind of because it was called Rise of Cobra, because... you have Joseph Gordon-Levitt playing Rex, who ends up becoming Cobra Commander. And and that's the thing people complain about. He's not wearing the mask, you know? Geez, did you not realize the mask from the original source looked like a KKK mask? Did you not want to see that in the movie? It's like, KKK, KKK. It's like... like I said, Dennis Quaid is fine. Everybody does fine. It's actually a fun, like, popcorn movie. It's like, the action's great, and it's just, it's not that bad. People make it, out to be a bad thing. I mean, I would love to see a third G.I. Joe movie. I mean, if it would be within continuity of the other two movies, I mean, kind of combine both the cast of both movies, maybe, and add some new characters. Because Snake Eyes and the other characters in the movie are great, because they set up these backgrounds of these characters, which I loved, because they would go do flashbacks here from time to time, and you understand the relationship between two characters, because there's this whole subplot here in the movie that has Snake Eyes and Shadow, and they're brothers, you see them in the past, you know, find each other. He's got the master, and Snake Eyes is all silent because his master died, and it's interesting how they integrate the flashbacks in this movie. It's just, I mean, Steven Sommers did a really good job with the directing. I mean, he had experience with a lot of the movies with The Mummy and stuff like that. So, I was like watching. I was like, that's okay, that's okay, that was good, that's okay. I was like, why are people shouldn't see people? If you want to watch a movie and you're looking at reviews, don't listen to them. Just watch it on your own and make your own decision, because you don't believe the reviews. Don't believe the reviews.
Well, here's my thing about it. All I remember about G.I. Joe, The Rise of Cobra were just a handful of things. And this is not a... And this is not a... A backing you up or a condemnation of your review?
No, it's just...
I personally found it forgettable and altogether. Because...
That's true.
Because I just... I watched it one night, and all I remember is... at the end... I could not... Even for Steven Sommers... this is such a cheap move. As soon as Cobra Commander comes into play, Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Yeah, I know.
Cobra Commander.
Exactly. Like, I cheated.
Wait. That was Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Yes.
Joseph Gordon-Levitt, the guy with the melty face.
Yes, that's him. From because they, if you were paying attention, because they were setting up that. You know, he was in the movie at the beginning, and there was a brother, sister.
I don't remember him being in this movie.
Yeah, he was, and he became Cobra Commander.
Now I just want to rewatch the movie just to point that out.
But after a while of wearing the, you know, he just sort of says, "Hey, I'm gonna go ahead and wear this cool looking black mask to cover myself up a little bit, and I'll talk this deep voice from now on." Then yeah. he's going on forward, and I'm hearing him breathing. I'm listening to him breathe through that mask, and it goes.
I mean, because
and it... I was like, I can't believe turned him into Darth Vader.
He, because when doing the voice, he said he kind of didn't want to copy the original cartoon voice, but he wanted to do something on his own, so he must have did that on his own thing when doing the voice, so it was like, doing the breathing, I was like, fucking copying Darth Vader.
Why? I mean, even for, like I said, even for Steven Sommers, I liked the, oh, by the way. I like the Mummy movies, except maybe the third one.
A lot of people say that. A lot of people say that.
The third one was okay. Like, I mean,
once you water down how many times you've ripped off Indiana Jones, it starts to show after a while.
Yeah, at least. But at least wasn't as bad as CGI Dwayne Johnson on Scorpion Body.
Oh yeah, that was terrible.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Even when I was young, I was like, God, no, please, why?
We have The Rock in this movie for about less than 5 minutes, and it's not even him.
Yeah, but even worse, you know what Cobra Commander reminded me of? Doom from Trank's Fantastic Four.
Yes! Yes! Yes, it makes...
I had the greatest superhero movie ever, and then the studio came in and ruined it.
I'm so tempted to, like, suggest to turn that, like, a riff track commentary with you guys. I mean, think of the possibilities. Oh, man. Oh, shit. Doom's a fucking scanner.
Yeah, it's just... Yeah, yeah, I mean, at the end, too, where Cobra Commander sticks the needle into Christopher, and he's like, and his face turns silver. He's like, what'd you do to my face? It's like, and it's weird because the movie starts out in the 17th century, where they set up the backstory of the company that he works at, and it's like, my great 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 parents, you know, were building weapons. Like, you didn't have to include that opening bit in like France, you know, and having the man in the iron mask bit. It was just like, it's a fucking G.I. Joe movie. You walk in the movie. I mean, what if somebody walked in the movie when it came out in theaters and it was like looking at the scenery of like 1700? It's like, is this G.I. Joe? Did I walk in the right movie?
They switched reels. They're playing Captain America, the First Avenger.
I was like watching the first, like, what? I was like, what? They could have just cut that bit off. It was like, cut that fucking shit off and edit better. But, I mean...
We sent the wrong film. We were supposed to get Wonder Woman in the next, like, 4 or 5 years. Shut it down.
In 8 years, we're gonna do Wonder Woman. Wait, we gotta save this footage. Destro. That's what I was thinking. It was Destro. The Destro face.
Let me put my medicine here.
And so yeah.
I just
after this film that we have, we have G.I. Joe Retaliation, which focuses.
I wonder if Jonathan Pryce.
I was just thinking about that because yes, Jonathan Pryce was in Rise of Cobra as the President of the United States, and I thought it was gonna selling point for you. It was like, hey, Morgan, Jonathan Pryce is in this movie as the president. But, I mean, now it's clever because there's a character in this movie that you see he pops up every once in a while, and you see him being injected with serums for his face to change and morph into somebody, and at the very end you see what happens to that character, and it's like, shit, now shit's for real now, because the guy gets ejected and his face transforms into the president, and then that's how they switch places. It's like, hey, thank you, yeah, President of the United States, and he's like, and you see him just reclining, and he whistles a tune, and you can tell by the tune he whistles, that's the guy from the movie. It's like, shit, now we got somebody from Cobra Command just in the White House now. Shit's gonna get fucked up.
Well, that gets, yeah, that gets, that's part of the plot that they go with the sequel, which,
I mean,
brought to us by the man who directed the Justin Bieber movie, by the way.
Yes, yeah. Well, and the same guy who eventually later on directs Gem and the Holograms.
Same. So how is this the one good movie that he directed? Or the one at least, I should say.
Wait.
I should say.
Who said Gem and the Holograms is a good movie?
No. No. You mix that up. You mix that up on purpose, you schmuck.
You're gonna say it's my dad. Schmucks.
Schmuck. Yuck.
Schmuck.
Yeah, John Chu, the guy who directed Justin Bieber, Never Say Never.
Yeah.
Somehow they got the idea that he makes documentaries. Let's hire him for a G.I. Joe movie. And I still can't remember everything that happens here. Just that Dwayne Johnson and and Ray Park is back as Snake Eyes. But for the most part, the cast altogether has been replaced, and I was actually wondering in a sort of a dark sense that if they were going to start the movie off by killing off all the other G.I. Joes and say, oh, this is our new group now.
No, yeah, well...
Don't go that route, but, oh yeah, Bruce Willis is in the movie. He's the guy who's the reason they call themselves Joes.
Yeah, the original man who's known... But yeah, John M. Shu, yeah, because he's known for the Step Up movies, which also starred Channing Tatum. It's like, a sequel for G.I. Joe. Channing Tatum was in the first movie. Maybe we can hire him for Retaliation. And then, let's see, John the Holograms. And then he recently has been doing the sequels for Now You See Me, which is weird. It's like, really? You go from Step Up, G.I. Joe Retaliation, Gem and the Holograms, then you go to Now You See Me 2, and now coming 3, which is...
Well, it's a step up from Gem and the Holograms. Ooh!
Yeah, so, I mean, if you want to see Dennis Quaid in a general role in G.I. Joe, The Rise of Cobra, he's fine. He's fine. He enjoyed... Mind you, everyone had fun while doing this movie. That's why Sienna Miller played the Baron, because she wanted to take a role that she didn't want to die, take drugs, or cry in. She wanted to do it just for fun. So everybody had fun making the movie. So don't crap on it because they just thought it was going to be a bad movie. They were having fun making the movie and just appreciate for what it is. It's a cheesy... action flick. That's all it is. And that's what G.I. Joe is, basically. It's very cheesy. I mean, even the cartoon was cheesy.
Oh, yeah. I have some PSA spoofs to show you guys.
And, of course, when you watch the movie, there'll be lines you hear, and it's like, oh, that's from the cartoon. Oh, that's from the commercial. Oh, yes, they are the real American heroes. Oh.
I'm not even thinking of it in terms of whether or not it was based on the cartoon. I'm just saying to myself, oh, it was an action figure line.
Yeah, it was
toys.
That's
the bottom. That's before everything, before the cartoon, before...
And it's weird, because, like I said, I was researching it, and they're kind of like basing it on the G.I. Joe comics of the 80s, like 1985, I believe they were like referring to a certain like storyline. And I think that the script was, like, old, too. Like, the script was written, like, in 1998. And it was based on that script because they wanted to make a 90s G.I. Joe movie. But, no, they had to focus on making Mortal Kombat instead.
Mortal Kombat is at least a little bit more memorable in my book. But I'm glad you enjoyed it.
I enjoyed for what it was. Yeah, I'm kind of looking forward to seeing what the sequel is and kind of.
Yeah, what DJ Caruso is gonna do with number 3.
All I remember is Snake Eyes. That's it.
And Snake Eyes is the best part. Like, he's the silent type, and he's just like.
Wasn't he unmasked in the sequel? I'm trying to remember.
Maybe.
Because they did the thing in the sequel where he has a brother.
Yeah.
And they're fighting each other, and I kind of like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I definitely thought the second one was better than the first one. I felt like the first one...
That's what everyone says.
Like, yeah, it was like it was establishing stuff, and the second was like, oh, this is better.
Ooh, yeah.
Bruce Willis, double check.
But, yeah. And of course...
Nowadays it's like, wait. Robin was in that? Really? The kid from Third Rock from the Sun? He's the villain? What?
Yes, Joseph Gordon-Levitt, yes!
I still can't rack my head around that one.
Yes, he becomes Cobra Commander. That's the Rise of Cobra. And of course...
Oh, it gets... It gets even better. The sequel had... had that one red-haired kid from Jurassic Park. All growed up.
How the hell I missed that one?
He looks so different now. Yeah, this is... this is him now. It's kind of amazing. Look.
I'm a discredit to my nature. Holy mackerel! Looks like a Calvin Klein model.
That's... Oh, yeah, that's right. That kid. I can see in the face now. I can see with the eyes a little bit. I can... He was so small in Jurassic Park. Holy shit.
This is him. This is him as he is now.
I'm surprised he's still acting after that. Oh my gosh. Most child actors.
Well, why wouldn't you want to act after you got shot off of an electric fence?
But he... Really, now I'm kind of looking forward to watching Retaliation if he's playing the new Cobra Commander.
He's not the new Cobra Commander. He's another character called Mouse.
Oh, okay. And I know what it is. Never mind. I was thinking of something else. I'm sorry. I was thinking of something else entirely. That's right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, it's kind of... I don't know. That's interesting enough. Okay. But yeah, it's just like...
Star Kid as Cobra Commander.
I'm sorry. I just... Like I said, I was the curiosity killed me because I had to see why were people so freaking like, it's a bad movie. I was like, really, bitches? It's not that bad. Let's see, Dwayne The Rock Johnson, da 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 da. Yeah, I don't think that's not the same. That's not the same person.
Ooh.
First, I don't know. Wait, I'm double checking my sources. For the cast of Almighty.
Bruce, Evan Almighty?
Oh, if you want to see me talk about Bruce Almighty, Evan Almighty, and the Holy Man, check out The Tipsy Gentleman. That's a great podcast.
You actually reviewed that one? Really?
Yeah, I had to talk to him about it.
Look at this grass. Look at this grass. It's amazing. Yes, amazing.
What the hell? Yeah.
That is when Eddie Murphy's career dipped for me, just playing this Gandhi-like character on the Home Shopping Network.
I know, it was just...
it is
the same guy.
Lawns. No, look at this grass, it's beautiful. Yes, yeah. Mow your lawns for $5.89, like this.
Yes, let's see. Bruce Willis. Chetty Tatum does come back in this, okay.
Oh, yeah, G.I. Joe Retaliation.
Yeah, he comes back as Duke, okay. Then Mouse, okay. Oh, Luke Bracey plays Cobra Commander. Oh, that fucker, okay. That one guy who ends up playing Johnny Utah in the Point Break remake.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, but it's just... I mean, Dennis Quaid has been in a bunch of other movies that we have probably haven't mentioned. I mean, we only talked about three. I mean, because, there's only three of us. Well, there's plenty of others. Like, you know, James said it was The Rookie, and there's... And, I mean, I mentioned A Dog's Purpose.
Day After Tomorrow. Day After Tomorrow.
Yeah, The Day After Tomorrow. Yes, what? That's... The Day After Tomorrow. What? Yeah, The Day After Tomorrow's nice.
What? Pumpkin? What?
The Footloose remake.
Oh, I was considering that at one point because in that movie, he's playing a character that John Lithgow did in the original, and, I mean, for what he was doing in the remake, he was doing his own thing with the character, and... I just think John Lithgow did it better in the original, where he had kind of more emotional, you know, understanding of what's going on. And Dennis Quaid was just like kind of sleepwalking through it, like he was just like being a straightforward pastor. I mean, in the Footloose remake, they actually set up a little bit more beyond the original. Like they set up the show. They show what happens to the town and why they banned dancing and music. The freaking car accident at the beginning, but it's just.
And let's not forget the classic Jaws 3D.
No,
you guys are forgetting the Parent Trap remake.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, well, but who
times the Lohan?
But really, who has seen the original Parent Trap with Haley Mills?
I mean, I got it on my playlist.
I have seen it.
I mean, how could... Get
together, yeah, yeah, yeah. We can have a swinging time.
I mean, how could you compare...
Da, 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 what do you do? The Parent Trap. It was so much funnier when they used the bear. And then instead of, like, having what's-her-name being floated to, like, into the middle of the lake. You don't remember that when they go camping and they, like, they attract a bear?
Oh, yeah. Oh, you're talking to me. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that's right.
I am talking to you.
Yes, you guys...
Mike is taking a swig, so it's quite clear I'm talking to you.
Yes, you guys are in the same position, by the way, so you guys can face each other.
Okay.
Oh, hi.
Nope, turn around.
Hey there.
Nope, wrong way.
Oh, hi.
There we go, perfect.
This is so weird.
You have no idea. When do we meet? It's gonna get weirder.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna see your face and it's gonna be right here. Mm-hmm. Right here.
Yep, I'm gonna see your face and it's gonna be right here.
Too close.
He played Doc Holliday in the 1994 Wyatt Earp movie. Actually, James did talk about a Dennis Quaid movie in the past in a Trilogies episode when he was in Dragonheart.
Oh, yeah. Which I was actually thinking about for a moment, and then I realized, wait a minute, I did Dragonheart as during the Trilogy episode. Whoa! You got my keys! What? Oh, wait. I got yours right here.
Whose keys are these? Did we just switch keys?
Oh, no. Do you drive a Plymouth?
I drive a Ford.
Yeah.
He was in Any Given Sunday. Frequency was a big one for him back in 2000, which now is a TV series based on that. So that's that popular. Far From Heaven, that's another one. In Good Company, the remake of Yours, Mine, and Ours.
The best date movie of the year, right next to Phenomenon.
Yeah, he hasn't done much. It's like he's an underrated actor, in my opinion. He does put out a decent performance depending on the movie. And what is he doing for television? Oh, that's right. He was an episode of SpongeBob.
Which one?
It says here he plays Grandpa Redbeard. So it's Grandpappy the Pirate from 2009.
Oh, here's a fun one I almost forgot about him. Vantage Point from 2008.
That's a good one. He played the president.
No, he played the president. He played the president's man. In that movie, the president was played by, what's that actor's name? I love you, wife.
William Hurt.
Yes. But yeah, he has to protect the president in that movie, and it's kind of, and this is kind of amazing. This is why I said he's the guy you get when you can't get Harrison Ford, because this seems like a Harrison Ford role, especially after Patriot Games and everything. No, Jack Ryan.
Hey, Dennis Quaid in Air Force One, get the hell off my plane.
But, you know, we should switch like every Harrison Ford role with Dennis Quaid.
See if it fits.
Quality. Yeah, see.
We could have him to like 6 days and seven nights.
In Witness.
Yeah, take the worst Harrison Ford movies made and just stick in Dennis Quaid, and see if that makes it better.
Yeah.
Or, worst case scenario, you can take Randy Quaid instead, like Ender's Game. Can you imagine how that would be like if Randy was in Ender's Game? Oh, we're gonna go off the planet! Go, kids, go! Ah!
We caused a war with an alien! Again! I'm back!
It'd be like Starship Troopers instead of like putting the kids in the control panel, they just send the kids to the damn planet with lasers.
Yeah.
Why are we playing this back on my planet? We call it rugby. It wasn't all this Capture the Flag bullshit.
Yeah.
Yes.
I remember watching Vantage Point and thinking to myself, actually, the one flaw in this movie is that.
Vantage Point with Randy Quaid.
Jesus. Oh, come on. Let's just stick Dennis's older brother into any other movie now. I just can't imagine them being related. It's weird.
I just can't open their last names are Quaid.
But if you look at Vantage Point, early on in the film, we realize that Quaid's character has got some baggage carrying because he got shot before defending the president. I was counting as the movie went on. Dennis Quaid gets in 4 car accidents as the movie goes by, and he gets out scot-free. You know, it's a total action movie thing. What? Bullets?
Well, that's interesting.
If you get shot, does that make you impenetrable to everything else that happens to you?
Wait, this is interesting. He turned down the role for Thomas Wayne in Batman Begins. He was offered a role for Batman Begins and turned it down.
Dennis Quaid?
Yeah, Dennis Quaid, to play Bruce Wayne's dad.
I would have turned that down. That's... they never have anybody it's not a memorable role.
Well,
to be honest.
It has to be, because you get fucking shot every time.
And they can hire anybody to do that. But you don't... You don't just get that as a cameo role and say, hey, oh, that was Dennis Quaid.
I mean, yeah.
I don't know. I think we've gone over a little bit here.
He tested for the role of Luke Duke in the Dukes of Hazzard in 1979. He would have been Luke Duke if it didn't go to Tom Wopat or Pat. It would have been them Duke boys, I mean. Okay, yeah, so next time we are going
Dukes of Hazzard with Randy Quaid, but in Uncle Willie's role. Is that his name, Uncle Willie? I can't remember. He was like, Willie Nelson played him in the movie.
Uncle Jesse, I believe.
Thank you, Uncle Jesse. Thank you. Randy Quaid is old Jesse. Really think about it.
It could work.
So much moonshine would be lost, man. He'd be going after Daisy's Dukes. You'd be driving around the General Lee trying to mow over boss hogs.
Oh my god.
Can you just imagine the General Lee going, wah! It'd be one hell of a Super Bowl commercial.
Okay.
It's official. We're doing a new one. Randy Quaid hijacks blank. And we already had him in the Rocky and Bullwinkle.
Okay. Next time on the podcast, we are going to revisit.
Randy Quaid hijacks Labyrinth. I brought you this. Zip, what is it? It's a crystal ball. But if you turn them this way, you look really nice. Like a mirror, you know?
When did Randy Quaid become homeless Bobcat?
I don't know. It just happened.
Oh, boy.
Oh, God. Oh, God.
Save the show.
Next time on the podcast. Okay. Next time on the podcast, we're going to revisit a old topic. We are going to revisit our birth years in film. So we're going to check out our birth year once more and see what other films we can dig up that we haven't talked about the first time.
Randy Quaid is Splinter.
The Michael Bay movies would make so much sense.
My son, you're gonna go out, steal pizza, and kick ass! Now go, my brother, and go!
And the ways of the people! Dance, hip-hop!
If he was in the Nutcracker Prince, it'd be a whole much better adaptation.
Playing
the
Mouse King.
Yeah, yeah. Just him and Keither Sutherland battling, it'll be just amazing.
That was already the best character in that movie, though.
Easily. And then the guy who played him, who actually plays him, is like a stand-up comic, so it's like, yeah, that works.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. Make sure you like this video if you like this. Please share this for fellow Dennis Quaid fans out there. Remember to subscribe to these two guys over here, Tommy Tude and Morgan Ledger here. They're great. They have their own YouTube channels. Just subscribe to them. They need more subscribers. And subscribe to me if you want to see more Cinema Royale. And thanks for watching. And yeah. Long live cinema, people. Long live cinema.
Me, Claudius.
Claudius?
Shout for now, bitches.